On behalf of the Department of Architecture, I welcome each one of the participants to this alumni lecture series, which is part of our Silver Jubilee celebration 1995-2020. The Department of Architecture is stepping into its 26th academic year now, and have taken this alumni lecture series to the online platform. So this is facilitating us to connect to a larger number of participants, and also our multifaceted alumni placed across the country and abroad. This session is the 8th lecture of the series, being an insightful session on conservation and restoration of heritage structure. So today we have with us our Dean, Faculty of Architecture and Planning, Dr. C.V. Subramanian, our Head of the Department, Architect Ramesh Babu, and the speaker of the day, Architect R. Anupadma. Thank you all for joining us. This is me, Architect Uma Mautika, Assistant Professor and Alumni Coordinator from the Department. Along with me, as part of the organizing committee, we also have with us Architect Balahari Krishnan, Assistant Professor, and Ms. Juan Jaffer, third year architecture students, who is coordinating the session today. I once again welcome each one of you to have an enlightening session today. On that note, I now invite our Dean, Faculty of Architecture and Planning, Dr. C.V. Subramanian, to deliver the welcome address.
Very good evening to all the participants who are there for this particular program. We have Architect Anupadma from Bangalore, who is going to address on this heritage. So on this note, this is a special program which is exclusively inaugurated by Periyar Maniammai Institute of Science and Technology from 2019. So the idea behind this program is to connect all our alumni who are placed worldwide. And every month we are planning and we are inviting one particular distinguished alumni to share their experience. After their graduation here, they would have gone to different institutions for their higher studies. And after that, they would have gone for practice. They would have gained a lot of knowledge. So after a long period, they are contributing back to the host institution. So in that line, today Anupadma, after extensive travel in different countries and good experience from academic angle and also from practice, she is also involved in various heritage conservation activities. So all the aspects or all the experience, whatever she has gained, so she is going to share with us today. And I'm very happy that a good number of participants have registered for this program. Apart from our own students who are very dynamic in participating in these type of programs, our student coordinator also is going to ask a lot of questions today in this program. We have our MArch students, those who have joined us first year in both the PG program, and also few first year students from UG program, those who have joined, they are also part of it. We have a good number of architects throughout the state, maybe as a practicing person and also as an academician. Out of their interest, they have registered for this program and they are participating in this. Really, it is nice that we all going to be benefited, especially my students will be very happier because an alumni from this institution is coming back and giving this special talk for the benefit of the students and for the architects. Coming to this heritage aspect, India is a very vast country where more than 3,000 plus ASA listed monuments are there or heritage structures are there. All this thing has to be given special care and attention. Like lot of ASA and other organizations, they are putting all their effort. Apart from that, as architects, we also need to support in conservation and all this restoration aspect. So I'm happy that today for this program, it is being initiated by the alumni coordinator and the faculty, dynamic faculty members of Periyar Maniammai Institute of Science and Technology. Thank you for the opportunity. Let us all listen to the organizing team and the special speaker. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. I request our head of the department, Architect Ramesh Babu, to brief on the topic of the lecture today.
Good evening. Good evening, one and all over here. I welcome all of you officially for this wonderful program. I also welcome our alumni Madam Anupama. We are very proud to have her here, to bringing here a lot of expertise which she has learned. And today, as our dean has already pointed out, India is a country where you have rich heritage and culture. So you go to each and every corner of your place, there will be some heritage structure or monument. So though there are a lot of agencies which have already listed, like right from ASI to UNESCO or whatever, international based agencies like UNESCO and local agencies like IMPACT, there are a lot of agencies are doing it. But even then, we keep on seeing a lot of structures within our locality. As a common person, we just admire them. We talk to our elderly people and we go and ask them what the structure is, what kind of thing. So that kind of interest we generally have as a layman. But as architects and architectural students community, we have a very responsible role of learning about conservation, learning the techniques of reviving the structure, and things which are very important that only a professionals like we can do. So in that context, students should generally cultivate the habit of appreciating the heritage and understanding how to preserve the structures, what are all the techniques involved, and what are all the agencies are doing this, and those kind of things. Another important thing I would like to mention about our department is every year we used to have something called as a heritage walk. So this heritage walk is something where we go and to highlight or to point out certain monuments or structures which is in our locality. And not only that, we also had played a vital role. Say for example, in our smart city projects, we can see we students, our department students, maybe your seniors, were involved in a heritage walk where we highlighted the importance of the Tanjavur moat, which is an important structure. So that has been taken up with the media, and today that has become a live project, and this that is being coming up now. Once it is done, you can appreciate the structure which is revived also. So by this, what I'm explaining here is this lecture can be a starting for all of you students and the architecture community to create an interest on this subject, and hope we do furthermore activities which will benefit the society and which will preserve our heritage and culture at a larger extent. So with this small note, I would leave the dais to our speaker, Madam Anupadma. Hope she will enlighten us with other more of her experiences. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. So introducing the speaker of the day, Architect R. Anupadma is an eminent alumna belonging to the fifth batch of Periyar Maniamma Institute of Science and Technology, PMCTW. She holds a master's degree by research on monument conservation from IIT Madras. She has a wide experience both as an academician as well as a practicing architect. She is currently working as associate professor at School of Architecture, Rewa University, Bangalore. She is a heritage enthusiast and has published many papers in international journals and conferences. She has been interviewed by BBC Radio and Sun News for contribution in granite stitching method as a repair solution to save stone built structure. She has also delivered conservation and research-related guest lecture in various institutions at Chennai and Bangalore. She has been inspiring students through her lecture to take part in heritage documentation and conservation activities. So today is one such inspiring lecture as well. I'm really happy to have her amongst us virtually, and thank you so much for accepting our request, ma'am. I request you to take over the session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Mama Otika. It's really an exciting moment for me because I have been hearing lectures in PMCTW, and now I'm here to give a lecture to my supra juniors. So I'm really happy to do it. And thank you, CVS sir, and thank you, Ramesh Babu sir, for giving me this opportunity. And shall we start it directly? Like, I just wanted to tell a bit like what Ramesh Babu sir was telling is a valid point. When we don't go around our locality and find the heritage structures and give some kind of a solution or a finding, maybe we don't, if we don't document the oral histories, what we know, it will not be shown or taken forward to the future generation at all. So it's really required for any region to know about your region when you go there and document whatever you have, at least like a in a form of a small diary or a presentation, and keep it off for yourself as an architect so that you can produce it somewhere. You can keep it like a hobby, like how people sing, write. So something like that, heritage enthusiasm can also become a hobby other than being a hard clear core research or consultancy work or something which will give you your job. That can be, this can be a separate hobby kind of a thing on a parallel line. So with just giving the basics on that, I would like to start the presentation now. So are you able to see the screen?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So this is about I have stitched this lecture together with whatever works I have done and the works which I have been a part when I was doing my master's in IIT Madras. So let's see the overview of the thing, basic depth. Apart from that, I have also taken something from online to give you a basic insight of basic definitions to come into a platform where we all know what I speak and what you know, everything together collated, and then we can speak on the same line. So the basic definitions about in conservation, we speak about different terminologies like conservation, preservation, restoration, retrofit, and how are they different from each other will be a big thing. So I would like to just brush up on that. Hope most of you will know that, but still a small intro on that. And then damage assessment part, how do we do it when we go to the site, what is preparedness for that, and damage mapping. So what is the ideal condition which has been done, and what more has been done. And then this is little think technical investigations. So what will be the technical investigations to find the possible causes of the issues or the damages caused in the monument, and the validation and trial projects, whatever we have underwent. I have just put very small and lighter presentation. So when we see preservation is an act to keep protecting the building, object, landscape, or any kind of a artifact which has a heritage or historical significance. What they do with the preservation is that they will not let you touch it or change it. You can just apply maximum of a preservative coat and then clean it and then maintain it. This Shor Temple has this issue. It's located in the shore of Mahabalipuram. As we all know, and it is facing a lot of issues in terms of salty breeze and then salt ingress. Because of that, a lot of deposits happening outside and also inside the pores of the material. So they just put the paper pulp treatment where they wet it, and then through capillary action they would just pull it out and then put a preservative coat over it. Apart from this, there will not be any intervention done to this particular temple unless and otherwise when it is most required. So ASI, and this is a UNESCO monument as well, so ASI is very keen on not touching it. So that is the preservation part. They won't add on to anything, or they won't reduce any part, and then they just leave it in. Even if it has little bit of damages or the surface level issues, they will just keep it in that part and preserve it for the future generation. That is called preservation. And restoration, I would like to explain you about this restoration with an example. And restoration is a kind of just recreating something with a form, feature, character, or property of whatever the monument or the structure was, to recreate the same thing to the future or to keep it alive. So this is a monument called Dresden Cathedral, which is called Frauenkirche, Kirche actually it's called as in Germany. And this monument is bombed due to World War II, and it is broken into pieces. So you can see the destroyed monument. So to appreciate the reconstruction part, we should know what is the speciality of the monument first. So what kind of a value does it has? So this monument is 18th century Baroque style cathedral, and it is destroyed because of the bombing of during the World War II, 1945. And they required around 100 cannonballs to destroy this dome and its significance. So this dome is overall the building, this dome is 96 meter high dome, and it is 12,000 ton weight heavy dome. So you can compare it to our big temple, what we have. So even the people around there were of the same connect to that cathedral. So the local people were all having a lot of love for that particular monument, and they had a sentimental and historic value attached to this monument basically. So this was just left like the form what it was in a destroyed form as a war memorial for about 50 years after the war happened. And then the local people, and when the Germany reunion started, they started collating the pieces. So they just collected all the stone blocks available there, and then they coded every single thing, that is called rubble sorting. So they just sorted all the rubbles, and then they have safely housed them in a place, and they contributed to the reconstruction or the restoration work of this particular monument. So the restoration work itself is not just happens like our home construction or something within 1 year or 2 year and all. It was happening for a decade and more. You can see it started, the idea started from 1992. So the sorting work started in 1992, and the completion of everything, and then with the function to start up the cathedral, it happened in 2006. That is the timeline which it took for the restoration work. So these are some of the pictures which you can see how the restoration work happened. And this is the old fired the stone blocks which were fired. They have all become black. So they tried to collect them together, and then they have created one particular window artifact alone on the building with the fired blocks. This just as remembrance. So almost 8,500 stones were preserved from that, and then they have treated it and used for this construction, and 3,500 stones were recycled, and then they have used it. And apart from that, they have also used new material to restore this building. So it was very obvious till some point of time, maybe with the time, the color has become of the same shades now. So this is the interior of the cathedral. So this is about the restoration. And retrofit is the thing where you have to strengthen the structure. It will be totally dilapidated apart from removing everything. And then you are strengthening it to increase the lifespan of the structure and to recreate it into its original form. So this is called retrofitting. And when we see conservation, all the process involved to retain the historicity of a place or a structure is called conservation. So they try to take or match materials of new materials also. Sometimes if the old material or the parent material is not available, they will try to match it mostly possible to the new material, but not totally drastically different. They cannot use glass over a monument, or unless and otherwise it has been used earlier. So it should be of the match to have the same effect. So it's like that. So for example, Charminar Hyderabad has the towers were weakened, and then they used little bit of new material and they have restructured it. Similarly, we have a Fort High School in Bangalore, and which was constructed by Chamraja Udaiyar around some 17th, 18th century only. And this school was constructed and it is being used for the students around. It's a kind of a government or subsidized cost run school. Intag has taken this project and they have renovated the flooring and other things were the cement floors with red oxide coating. Now they have changed it into Kota stone, and then they try to reconstruct the Madras terrace roofing in the school complex, and also the woods were preserved, and then they have put it in position, and they have used a little bit of Artangudi tile also for the walls and in some places of the floor. So this is all about conservation. And when we see renovation, which we do to our homes anytime, so it's like it's just updating it either to your status or to the current trends or whatever. And there is another thing called adaptive reuse. This is a very close to my heart example from internet. You will get to see this very easily when you put adaptive reuse in Google. So it's House of Vans in London example. So what they have done is they have reconstructed a 6 railway line. You can see there are 6 bays here. So they have given a new use or purpose for the building. So it was a railway line. Now they have transformed that into a skate park, auditorium, and a theater. This is a skate park area, auditorium, theater, cafe, bar, and a gallery, art gallery attached to it. And they have set a lab also here. So together they have transformed the use of the building, but to keep the ethnicity of the building, they have prepared it for a longer life. So this is adaptive reuse. Initially they'll do basic assessment to see if the building is strong enough to go ahead with this kind of activity. From one activity to other, generally they will propose lighter activity than what it was in the current times. So this is the entrance ramp leading to the building, and this is the cafe and theater inside, and this is a skating park. So we have seen what and all we have do to a monument or a built heritage structure. So why do we do it? We need, there are so many causes. If you see a building in general will undergo so many issues because of different causes, maybe due to fire, as we can see our Notre Dame Paris, and then the earthquake. We have seen Burj earthquake, because of that many monuments were damaged. And then we have other things which is not very visible to our again, bombing. I have given one example due to the war. There will be essentially an attack on the monuments because they are considered as a treasure of any nation for that matter. So that is another thing. And apart from that, we have other things which is not really visible to our eyes, like acid rain, and then climate change, and then the salt in the air might get ingressed into the building, and it will cause the some problems to the structure, and the water rise from the ground. So this is a very nice, and even sometimes our monuments are very old, and they are like our grandpa and grandma. Okay, so they are not even used to the traffic and the vibrations created by traffic. So that might also affect them. And as they have crossed so many years, their building material would have also become little less stronger to take all these things. So this is a very nice picture which is inherited from my professor Matthews. So he used to show us, and in this one single picture, you can see all possible causes or irritations which were caused to built heritage. So what do we do now? So we know what are the problems, what are the repair method, the conservation, what are the different types of conservation we do, and we know there are some causes which is causing all these things. So how do we do by documenting them? So when we see, before going to a documentation process to a site, we need a proper literature study to know about the context, the issue, the study area properly. So apart from that, literature study plays a major role when you do the initial study about a site or an issue or whatever, or about the practice in between, or to orient you towards a solution. Again, you need literature study. So it's not so far away for you guys. You are in this age and it is just available for you in the tip of your finger. So internet searching is always possible for you to learn more. And you are in this era, you are more fortunate to have internet to use it for the best cause. And regarding the next stage would be a damage assessment, which we can go to the site and you need to document whatever are happening there in the to the monument. Maybe you would have advised about what is the issue, why you are called to the site, but you should do the basic study about the site, what it is, where is it sitting, what would be the basic analysis or the basic data about it you should collect, maybe the basic drawings also you should collect, and then you should move forward to the case study. I'm just explaining this with a case study which I have done during my master's period, and this is on the National Art Gallery, Egmore, Chennai. This was given as a assignment exercise to us to document and then show the damages, possible damages which are existing in this art gallery. So this art gallery, literature-based base or the idea. I'm just recreating the situation when you go, what you should do. So the National Art Gallery was built during the celebration of Queen Victoria's Golden Jubilee year. And it was built with sandstone. Architect of this monument is architect Henry Arvin. And this was recognized as heritage site by CMDA. It's a local state heritage site. It's not a international or national level recognized one. It's a state heritage site. In 2002, it had got a lot of damages in it, including settlement, plant growth, many other cracks, and then structural damages, everything together. It was in a very bad situation. When you go there in, the roof will fall on your head. That was the situation. So they just locked it in 2002 for tourists or any people to get inside it. After a long wait, it had started its conservation process in 2016, it seems. I had just got to know about it by Times Now. This monument is the most celebrated monument earlier, maybe during my childhood days or during my college. And the most famous Chandralekha song was shot in this monument. Hope all of you know. And it was the initial time Ear Rahman hit. So this is a sandstone monument. So we were thinking what we could do, and then we found the Spitzner's classification scheme for every single lithotype. Lithotype is nothing but the stone as a material. So we have taken a browse through, and then we found the Spitzner's classification scheme. He is a German scientist who is working extensively on Athens, Jordan monuments and all. So he is a pro in this particular field. So he had done top to bottom. He had analyzed whatever maximum problem to minimum problem which can happen to a stone monuments. So his basic thing were on limestone and sandstone monuments. So we chose it from him. So how did he classify the weathering forms? Weathering forms are nothing but the surface level damages which happens to a stone, because unlike other building material, the main reason for making monuments in the stone masonry is to make it more durable. So concrete was not available back then. So they just started quarrying stones and they made it more permanent. Initially, they were constructing with timber, clay, brick sort of materials, which were not that durable compared to the stone. So they all transformed to stone to make it more permanent. So that's how the transformation happened. And again, after so many years, the stone is also suffering some problem. So he grouped the basic surface level problems into four groups. And further, he had divided that based on the main weathering types. Again, different groups were done. And based on that, individual weathering forms were determined. And he made a huge atlas for this. And then he differentiated individual weathering forms also further based on the intensity of damage happened to that particular weathering form. So this is the extent. He saw damage at a visible deterioration as visible deterioration and non-visible deterioration. We used to say, right, macro to micro level we should think. He thought beyond macro to micro to nano level. So that is the invisible deterioration. So that requires laboratory analysis essentially to be done to find the cause. So when you see the types of thing, we categorize that from the surface. We were not allowed to go inside the monument now. We were just asked to go around the monument, see what is happening, see how the plinth is doing, how the base is sitting on the floor, is it settled inside or it is standing out, whatever possible we can see around. From that we have to take photograph and document it. So what we have just followed the weathering form scheme based on Fitzner, and we started sorting it out. So
No, you can continue. It's by mistake.
Okay. Oh, no problem. Okay. So, based on the loss of stone material is the first type group, in which you can see due to the scales is a irregular surface peel out or just separation of the surface layer, which is not a regular thing. And another thing is loss of crust, which is a uniform peel out of the surface layer. And alveolar is a kind of a hole, honeycomb kind of a effect happens over the surface, that's called alveolar. And you have other stone particles were just crumbling out of it, which are weak on the surface, that will be pushed out due to some reasons for that matter. Again, when you see there is other type of stone material loss is due to breakout, sometimes due to rain or the water ingress from the ground. This breakouts, like it just peels out because of the salt ingress along with the water when it rises from the ground, and due to the rain again, due to the lot of deposits in the crack which were existing before, it will just open up and it will break out. So apart from that, the man-made holes to connect the new interventions into it is called anthropogenic impact. And you have other things like due to the biological colonization also, you have some layers formed on top of it, or the breakout happens because of this, the relief, whatever has been done, that will get broke out totally. So this is the first set of damages which happens because of the loss of the stone surface material. Next is a discoloration or deposit, which will happen when rain falls on a monument. After it is dried, the possible polluted material and sometimes the salt and other things which just forms on the layer, and that will cause a kind of a discoloration. Sometimes it will just wash off the mortar, and that chemical reaction whichever happens along with the rain with the mortar, that will also reflect on the surface, and then that will create a kind of a odd color on the surface. So sometimes due to fire, as we have seen in Dresden Cathedral, because of the fire, the material has become black. That is again a form of a discoloration. And sometimes due to dropping of bird, and sometimes due to efflorescence, this is purely because of the salt decay happening in the material. And sometimes the color gets lightened. Sometimes it changes the surface totally. And some plant growth or biological colonization, like formation of fungus on top of it, and all those things are a kind of a damage which will which if it is led for a long time, it will essentially cause a more severe problem to the monument. So these are these forms in the group 2. In group 4, this monument particularly had group 1, 2 and 4 kind of damages. So this is about fissure and the structural damages or any kind of a deformation happened to the monument that will be highlighted in it. The cracks or the fissures which are formed can be in the monument or sometimes the mortar in between the building units will get washed off due to the time and due to the wetting and drying process and all. So due to that also again it will get deformed away from the original position. So based on this we just done, and whatever we were able to find it online, we just took all the pictures and we documented it what were at the surface level, little bit zoomed into the scale and the overall. They had a lot of cracks, more of a plant growth on it to give a appropriate solution. So like this, if you are given with any kind of an issue, you can do a basic summary of what you have seen in the site, and you can document and keep them also as an assessment. And to summarize, what are the major problems in any monument you can see is the loss of stone material in the surface, weathering problem, surface level, stone monument specifically, and discoloration and deposits, detachment. This is something happening with Kailashnatha temple, Kanjipuram. So that temple is made of sandstone. This is not possible with the granite monuments, but it is very much happening in limestone and sandstone monuments basically. So what happens is that the building itself will crumble, or the building unit itself will crumble. The features, the sculptures will go, like hands, legs will just go, and then the remains will only stay. So it's like that. The material becomes sand. So it's like that. The binding material will lose its position or it changes. And unlike even Bradeshwara temple has signs of this, but not that easily granite will get to this detachment mode. So it was already diagnosed, and they have started replacing the new stones as well. So fissures is the fourth form of it, fourth group. So after this assessment, whatever we have seen, what generally they do is mapping. Mapping is measure drawing of a building. Generally, the thumb rule to touch a monument or to conserve a monument is to fully document the state of the monument in its current situation. So you should do proper drawings of all those things, and then you should monument it with a lot of photographs to show what it was and what had, and the process of conservation should also be documented to give the final product. So it should be properly documented and kept because it has a lot of heritage values, sentimental values and many other values attached to it. So if something happens in the future, you should not be fired also, and you should have so much of care and interest in doing that. So this is the Taprum Cambodia monument, and it is a huge complex called Mahayana. It belongs to Mahayana Buddhist monastery and a university, and it is called Raja Vihara. And this belongs to Bayon architecture. It was built by Jayavarman, who is the king of the region in 12th century CE. So this temple was given as a project to IIT Madras, where our professors, Professor Devdas Menon, Mahaprasad Sir, Professor Matthews, all of them were there. I just did a minuscule help on collating some details, and then monitoring part, collating details of the monitoring part and doing some small sketches to it. But still, they gave me the exposure of knowing what's happening in the monument. So this monument is a sandstone, limestone monument. So they have both the material in it. And then this monument's issue is the trees had grown over the monument because it was left without notice for quite a long time inside a forest. So the trees had just grown over the monument. Now, if they remove the tree, the monument will collapse. So they are into a thing to maintain both the tree and the monument. So they are supporting. Here also you can see some supports. So the everywhere, wherever the structural members are there, that are supporting the tree and the monument together to preserve in its condition. So in 2013, ASI had completed this conservation work. So this particular thing had come to ASI, and ASI had formed a collaboration with IIT Madras. So what they have done, there is a structure called Hall of Dancers, which is totally crumbled. You can see how it is crumbled here. And then what they have done is the in situ mapping they have done of the crumbled structure, the floor plan, totally including the blocks and other things, everything they have recreated it in the form of a drawing. And then this is the ceiling plan or roof plan of the particular structure from the top at different levels. And then what they have done is they have sorted the material, the individual building units, and then they marked the number of it, and then they have totally replaced it in its position and documented the same. As I told you, no, even the conservation work will get documented. So it is properly documented. You can see different site elevation with the numbers, and even the site has the numbers marked on it, the in the chalk or something like that. So all these things were put into the its position. So this is how they do it in ASI. They do this. This is a tedious process. It's like a puzzle for them. Even any kind of a gone down building, they will just sort it and then they will put it in place to some extent, and then they start adding the new material which are close to the original material, and then they'll start doing, and they'll never intervene with new material like steel or any other plastic or any other synthetic materials. Basically, they would like to choose the material which are natural and which can be decomposed very easily. So they are very eco-friendly. So this is all about the mapping or the drawing of drawing and then documentation part of mapping, which has been done in ASI. And about a digital mapping with the quantification is another project which we have done. This is again given to us as a project. This was my master's project with the support of 8 lakhs. They have awarded it to us to with a lot of issues with Shore Temple, Big Temple, Tanjavur, Gangaikonda Cholapuram Temple, and there was another Shiva Temple in Kiranur also. Together 5 monuments they have given it to us with all the problems, possible problems existing in that, and they wanted a solution. So I'm just showing just 2 of them with the minimum problems which I can explain within the time allotted to me. So this is Shore Temple. As I told, it was undergoing, it's in the saline environment, and it is undergoing a lot of salt decay issues. So this temple, to give an introduction, as you all know, it's from Pallava dynasty, 7th-8th century monument, the first structural or the earliest structural temple of the Dravidian style. And it was built by Rajasimha Mahamalla, who is supposed to be the best architect of the period. So he this 1200 years monument was built as for ceremonial purpose only in the show, is what they say. And it has 2 shrines with a tower, and 1 shrine dedicated to Vishnu just behind the small shrine. So again, based on Fitzner's grouping, I have documented the damages happening all around the monument into 2 groups. First group is the loss of material, where you can see the rounding of the sculptures. Because of the abrasion of wind and pitting happening, is like it just starts having small pores, surface level pores like that. And then the scaling was happening. You can see, if you go there, you can really see the real surface of the material, and this will be different scales. Kind of a disintegration happens on the surface layer, roughening of the texture, and alveolar. This is again due to the wind action. It just scoops off some material slowly, and then it takes it off. So this is about the group 1 classification of weathering forms in Shore Temple. And group 2 is discoloration or deposit, which is essentially due to efflorescence and the salt deposit on the monument. And some of the bird dropping were also found in that. So they do meticulously every year. They used to put the paper pulp, remove all the salt from the monument, and then they will just keep it proper, leave it for some days, and then they'll put the preservative coat on this. This is essentially done at a interval of time regularly by ASA, but still it is undergoing. They were asking, is there any ways to do something, at least to document the damages? So what we have done is we had got a software from Germany, which is called Meticomap 2.2. Now 3.0 is available. This is offered from 2001, and we have got 2004 version. And it's a combination. How it works is all about what you can quantify in CAD, like area quantification and all, you can do it in CAD, right? So similar kind of a thing, and whatever you can do with image processing softwares. So it's a combination of both the things. So the problem for us is to have a photographic base. It will not take any kind of a sketched elevation, because obviously you cannot quantify the damage in elevation. Again, to plot it, you don't even require this software if you're drafting the elevation and plotting it, isn't it? So we required a true scale corrected elevation. So if you take a photograph, it will anyways form into a 3D image. You cannot get an elevation out of it. So we were thinking about it, and we got the introduction of photographer Mr. Natarajan, and he agreed. He is a monument photographer. So he just gave us an idea to do a photo montage. So we had properly erected a structure in front of it, a scaffolding. And then we started from the bottom line till the stube of it, the topmost part. We took some 250 photographs, and he had nicely montaged them together to give a elevation of it. We could do, it's really a costly process. We had only funds to do only one side. So we have chosen the southern side, which is most affected due to the saline environment. Other sides at least could manage with some kind of trees and other things. It's not much damaged, but the southern side is most damaged. So we have taken the larger shrine, and we have documented that part alone. So as we have got the montaged photograph, we have taken that into the software. The software, you have the option to magnify the locations along with the photographer. Even I climbed all the levels to see and then note it down in my notebook or the picture what we have, what are the major problems, where it is happening, to see it with normal eye. And then we have documented all possible things. The advantage of this is when we start mapping them, it automatically gives the area or the percentage of damage happening in it. So like Photoshop, what we do based on layers, we have to just map it in layers. That's it. And finally, we have got group one and group two damages based on Fitzner's thing in the elevation. So this, along with that, we have also done the mapping of the parent material. So what it was, only damp-proof course was in a stronger granite material, and the topmost pinnacle part is in the stronger material, black granite, and other things are of a little weaker granite, not too much weaker granite. Granite is never weaker at all. And then repair materials, whatever they have added in due course of time, all these things we have documented, and this is what is the quantification we have got out of the software. And we have done it based on the seriousness of the issue or the intensity of the issue. We have to address the problem. And the other, as I told you, it's again an ASA project. They have come to us to see mostly our big temple, or which is in your region. So this, our big temple has a lot of structural problems than the surface problem, because and they did had some microscopic invisible deteriorations happening in them. So it generally doesn't happen, weathering forms doesn't happen with a granite monument easily, and it is 1,000 years old, obviously it is old. So these things will happen. So to document it on a lighter version, you have some scales found on it and granular disintegration started forming. So this granular disintegration gave us an idea to do a detailed investigation on it about what is happening, why is this happening with the granite, which doesn't even happen very easily on a granite monument. And it, the master architect of the temple had really chosen the best granite out of the world, so that could survive for so many years now. And some breakouts happened, and this soiling happens in any temple for that matter. Everyone will go do lit the lamp, put it on top of it, and they'll take this vibhuti and kumkuma and put it on the temple only. I don't know why they are taking it from God and shaming the God himself. So even in spite of having the boats and other things, it has been happening there. So discoloration due to the change, chemical change in the material. And then when you see in the tower Vimana area, you can see some the beam or the lintel, which is totally getting crumbled. It was the scenario during 2007-8, I believe. I hope they would have replaced everything now. They were an idea to replace the beam with the support and interventions. So I don't know what is the existing condition now. And they had some soiling due to the bat excretion, and then some cracks in the capital. These things were all happening here, right in the entrance. So these were the damages which ASA people showed us. And the major issue for them is to stitch the inscribed column, which was broken. So ma'am, sir, please do something to stitch it together and keep it forever. So they have this habit of mending them together with the help of mortar in between. So, and then, but still it will not last long, right? So they have to keep on doing it. So they wanted a new method or a solution for this particular issue. So I'm getting little technical. Please bear with me, because pushing the limits is always important to find something new. Okay. So we are getting into the diagnosis to find the cause. So as doctors give, we also have different prescriptions. These are like vitals. When you go to the doctor, again, our Tata is not well, so we are taking him to the doctor. So we have to do from the material, whatever available there, we transported it into our lab, and then we were testing about the mechanical condition of the material, and then the physical condition of the material, chemical condition of the material, what are the minerals present in that. And these are kind of a vitals. So, and again, we had to do some more validating tests or the weathering tests to find what are the possible causes. You can relate this to X-ray, MRI scan. So such kind of tedious tests these things are. Okay. So we did all the experiments possible in the laboratory. And then these are about the test reports of Brahadishwara temple. Okay. Test reports of her Tata. Okay. So this is about the mineralogical composition. So what was it? Mostly it had quartz as a material which was holding them together, and they didn't have any easily disintegrable mineral in it, and the chemical compositions were properly checked. And we also had the surface problems were happening. So we took some stones which were broke out from the site, and we did SEM test, and then we could see we have done a detailed analysis of what are the mineral, what are the changes happened to the old stone. And then we could see that there is a process called scalinization happening in the old stone. What is scalinization? Is the feldspar or the potassium feldspar, which is a mineral present in the stone itself, due to the time it is getting transformed to a clay mineral or a clay. So this will form disintegration of the material. It forms on the surface is okay. You can always put a preservative and save. What the same thing happens over the crack, which is formed due to the age or the time or the micro cracks inside. So it is actually getting catalyzed by the HO2 or the water, acid rain, water from the rain, and plus CO2. So now the climate change is not only causing problem to everyone, it is causing problem to our heritage also. So it's actually getting aggravated, and then the disintegration and then crumbling were all in there for big temple also. That's why they are replacing the old stones, because sometimes it will become too much brittle and then it will just open up. It's all because of this particular problem. So they started changing it to a new building unit, the surface level, whatever happens. It doesn't happen in the interior and all, but because it's a very strong material. You can never compete with granite with any other material. So it's the most durable one. And the inscription, column, which was totally broken, and they want to mend them together. So we had to do this laboratory validation for stone stitching method. This just arose to us because we were working as a team with Reach Foundation, which is an NGO which is organized by heritage enthusiasts and ASA retired people. And they were saying, when we went for the trial, I'll show you that monument, what, or the temple, which was totally ruined. They were saying that generally we have a thumb rule of stitching the lighter material with the stronger material. So brick wall, if it has a huge crack, we will fill it and we will stitch it with a stone. So just then we got this idea. So the more stronger material is a stainless steel or a steel than the stone. So why can't we do these stones generally get broken because of the flexure or shear. Flexure is just loading, and then shear happens because in earthquake and all, multiple side forces acts, and then the shear damage happens. So we wanted to test it by stitching them in a flat position and also in a 45 degree angle, and we did with all the setups. You can see all the setups, and we were also using epoxy glue to fix the stainless steel in position inside. So putting all the three material together, how it works, how is the bondage, we wanted to do pull out test, and again with all the setup we have done the laboratory expeditions over. So we have done with several stones or new stones. Obviously, we won't be able to get so many stones from the monument itself. So we have taken the new stones and then we have experimented on it in the laboratory, and then the stitching at site. What has to be done? The cracks which are 1 centimeter or more in width, those things we have selected, and you have to drill hole across the crack. And then with the help of a drilling machine, and then clean the crack for any kind of a dust to improve the bonding capability, and then to put the epoxy based adhesive into it, and then insert the stainless steel rod. Why stainless steel rod? Underlined bold, because it has the capacity of non-corrosion. So any other rod, if you put it inside for stitching, again you will have the issue of corrosion, which will again aggravate the problem. So it should be a stainless steel non-corrosive material. So we have chosen stainless steel rod with the laboratory expeditions. We have found what is the thickness of the rod should be, maximum thickness of the rod, diameter, everything were determined. And we have put it appropriately. And then to finish it, to give the similar finish of the thing, when we grill, the dust will form, right? So just put it over the surface. So this is that Kailashanatha temple in Uttramerur, which is where they have done the stone stitching over the brick and the stainless steel stitching over the stone. So we were called to do the basement or the plinth or the kalharam, they call in the specific language of temple architecture. So that base, they wanted to stitch them because that was totally deformed. So it shouldn't further detort, and then it shouldn't make the over superstructure to fall down. So we had to stitch this thing, and it had also become a validation site for us, where we can do it before we put it forward to big temple, as it is of a higher significance. So this temple is no lesser. It is a 8th century temple, 1200 years old temple, which was left without any maintenance, and it is totally down. The front mandapa had gone totally. And then as we had ASA expertise in our team, Reach Foundation, we could put sort them and then put them back and then make it into a fresh monument back into its position. So what we did is, again, across the crack we had identified some 2-3 spots, and then we had put drilled the hole, put the adhesive inside, epoxy based adhesive. We used Hilti's one, and then we inserted the stainless steel rod and then finished it with the parent material. So that was the condition of this temple, and it was renovated into this. Even the mortar, the combination mortar with little bit of cement mixed to the lime mortar, they have done it in the site with the machine, everything set up in the site. We could go see that, and then we could go measure, we could go till the first tire of it. So it was a really fabulous experience which I will never forget all through my life. And my repair method, sorry, our repair method was also validated in this, so it is very close to my heart project. And apart from all the structural issues, we also had this silly, not a silly project, it's because we just get updated, and we want every heritage structures also to get updated. We put happily oil paint over that. That is actually stopping the breathability of its structure. The stone by itself is very strong. Why do you have to put some color and make the monument look something different? So they had done it, and the new owner or the Dharmagatta approached us through Reach Foundation, and then they wanted to find what is happening, sir, how do I remove it. When we gave a lecture about the breathability of the stone and the structure, how it has to be natural and all, then he got enlightenment, and then he wanted to remove it all of a sudden. And then we called the Karcher, which is again a German based company who are pro in cleaning. So we just didn't want to do it all of a sudden. So we had done some trials, like they had different types of cleaning method, jet cleaning, fan jet cleaning, and also foam cleaning. So we identified just two columns in the temple, and then this temple is in Chemanjeri, Chennai, Srinivas Perumal temple. And then so those two columns we experimented it. We first taken a photograph of how it is, and then we experimented with a jet blaster, and then with a fan blaster. And then we altered the pressure. We didn't want to do it with full pressure clean, fat, finish it off, nothing like that. We did it with the different pressure levels. We tried it out with the one column, one point, and then see how much it is removing the surface, and then how much it is damaging the thing and all. And then we have given a proper results to it. So they were able to clean. It will take some 2-3 times with a lesser pressure or the optimal pressure, but still that is required to save the material. So this is about the foam jet intervention, what we tried there. And then it could clean very nicely the paint. The paint is not only one layer. They have put one layer of normal paint over that. They have put another oil paint over it, and then they have properly made it breathless. So that was the issue which was happening there. And then we have done with the different pressure levels, and we have recommended on dirt blaster how much it should be, you know, foam, where, what it can do, oil, the anthropogenic issues, or the oil put on the surfaces, stains, those things are good for with the, you know, foam cleaning. And the dirt blasters are better compared to the fan blasters with the recommended pressure levels. So this is the recommendation given by us to for the further cleaning. They did the cleaning and made it without pain free now. So with this, it's all done. These are some of the references which you can refer. You can always go if you want. There is a huge atlas for stone monument or the stone weathering forms done by Fitzner. It's easily available online. And thank you so much for the opportunity. Hope I didn't bore or take too much of time. If you have any questions, I'm open for it.
Thank you so much, ma'am, for giving us such a wonderful lecture. Because as students, we are just budding architects. and it is indeed very important for us to attend these kind of amazing lectures once in a while to gain knowledge in our field. So on that note, thank you so much for giving us a lecture. And now I would like the participants to come forward and post your queries in the chat box so that it will be easier for us to read out the speaker and she'll be sorting it out.
It's really good that it was very interesting about all this stitching method. Really, like doctors are doing wonderful work. Same way as an architect, it is interesting that you are stitching out all the heritage and monumental structures and making it. By knowing your talk, your batchmate Sherlyn Deepa from Singapore, she is an urban planner. She is also got into the lecture session. She is also as one of the participants today. And for all the participants, if any questions are there, it can be posted into the chat box, or you can directly ask to the resource person today. To start with, see, many architects students are attending this program, and architects are also there. We would like to hear from Anu Padma about this heritage tourism, because there's a wide scope for it. So apart from monuments, all those things, a lot of heritage structures are lying there in every part of town, not only in Tamil Nadu, all over India.
Yeah.
So that's the scope for architects. Maybe can you share about that? Meanwhile, other participants can share their questions in the chat box or come on live.
Yeah, sir. Heritage, not only Tamil Nadu, India itself is a heritage, the country which is rich in culture and heritage, basically. So when we see that way, abroad when you go, they have a small monument for that. They'll give a huge ad marketing, and then we go there, enjoy. They make the place surrounding also more enjoyable. Maybe they'll make us to walk through a trail or something like that to see that monument. So such kind of additions which will not really bother the monument itself, and then to give that much of boom for that particular thing is also required. And before all those things, we should know the value of what we are sitting in. Sometimes in heaven we will not appreciate what is heaven, so we should know what heritage structures we have and how we can actually, I'm sorry, my battery is running low. So what we have to do, and then we should document all those things and then really renovate them. For if it has the real value of tourism, we should actually document and then put it forward, take some funds, and then do some justice to it. Like for example, Devanahalli Fort, which is existing in the Airport Road in Bangalore. That was just like that left. Nada Fort is also just next to Devanahalli Fort is existing, Chikkajala Fort. That was just taken for the widening of the road, which they have laid between the city and the airport. Quarter of that fort itself is swallowed off. When I saw this in the paper as a news, it is really bleeding in my heart, actually. So these things, they just leave it because they don't really find it more important, because they are just there. They see it every day. Like we don't really value our grandpa and grandma. Similar to that, we don't value our monuments also. So we should put little more efforts to see what is there, how we could, what are the values it contains, and then how we could really contribute to the renovation of that, and then put it forward. And then you should know the value of it to seek it out and to make it a tourist spot. So even the Devanahalli thing, you can even, they have very old structures made of cobble still existing, more than 150 years. And then it obviously, sir, you know the bioclimatic value of that particular home, and it has the vernacular typology houses also. They say Tipu had stayed there before going for hunting and all. So it has so much of value, so they should obviously have to conserve those things and keep it as an art gallery or something, develop some revenue to save it, and then to spend on it, earn from it, spend on it. Some scheme you should develop.
Okay, thank you.
Hello.
Yes,
Ramesh Babu here. Very good lecture, actually.
Thank you, sir.
In fact, it was tailor-made for our students in a very simpler way, and I hope everybody understood each and every slide. It was really interesting. gave a nice comparison between doctor and the scenario, so that can reach the students very well. That's what really interested us. I have some questions. It's not a question actually. Generally, since you are talking more about stone structures, stone monolithic structure. Yes. My question is about the lost manual. What I mean by a lost manual is, when we are creating something, there is a manual for restoring and maintaining and all these things. Like any product, say for example, we are getting a washing machine, for example, you will get a manual and everything along with that. Yes. In a simple way, I understand that all our temples had a way of arrangement of these rocks. Like if you talk all these stone structures, right, from Brihadeshwara temple to any temple, these were all assembled and locked in a special way. Yeah. I heard from one epigraphist, it's very famous, Kodavail Balasubramaniam. So he said there was a manual for the South Indian Dravidian temples in a way how these rocks were assembled. Mm-hmm. And somebody could read that manual, they can recreate the temple. Like if you can go to a temple and straight away you can disassemble it and assemble it in order.
No.
And that is done because each and every stone cubes has a kind of engraving, a number, a code. And he told that the temple was there in Mayiladuthurai somewhere.
Okay. So
I would like to understand if any kind of studies is done to decode that particular engraving, because all these manuals were given as in inscriptions in this temple.
Yeah. Big temple is a live manual, sir. Along the plinth, if you go, they have even documented about the economic activity, what they have given, what fund to buy bananas for the Ganesha Puja. That is also documented in that. Just that you should know the script reading. That's it. So I think the temple architects who are really doing it as a hereditary job, there is a temple architecture school also in Mahabalipuram, where we also spoke to the Sthapathis before we gave or we did any kind of a laboratory test to see what can be removed, what can be supported and all those things, because they are really the traditional building method followers who know top to bottom about the temple than us. So to learn from them and then to hear from them and then document it to be easily available for any layman should be done, sir. That is essential. That is a set of research, or you can just start it in your research cell and then you can just go ahead with generations of students to get it updated. So, because I even watch a lot of Kodavail Balasubramaniam sir's lecture. Every lecture, you will find something new.
Yes,
it's always true. Like that. Like how we visit the monument, every visit we see something new. Every visit is exciting when you really love it, obviously. So it's like that.
So we need to search the manual in our local area.
Oh, yeah.
Following the foreign context.
Yes.
Thank you.
Ma'am, I would like to read out a question from the chat box.
Yeah.
We are all aware about the Victoria Memorial in India. When its conservation process started, the government authorities took off all the colonial statues from the monument. So is that advisable to do so? Because each and everything that has happened in the past marks the history. And if it's preserved, it allows the younger generation to gain more knowledge from it. So I just wanted to know your opinion based on the above scenario.
So I don't think the Victorian sculptures, whatever you have told, were existing on the surface of the wall. Was it on the surface of the wall? Or it was kept in front of it? I remember one Victoria statue was kept in the premises, just in front of the art gallery. Maybe that would have got some issue on its own, or they have removed it for the ease to reconstruct the monument. But other than that, I don't think the authorities will just remove it for the sake of removing it. That shouldn't have happened at all, and no one else would leave it to happen also. We have different authorities, NGOs like INTAG, other heritage enthusiasts around. So it's not that easy to remove a monument from a place.
Ma'am, are the process involved in restoration and conservation always out of trial and error method? Harshika and Nusrat.
See, it's always, because when you introduce a new method, then it is trial and error. But the known, tested, time-tested method, there is no trial and error. They'll just go forward and do the conservation restoration process directly. If you are intervening something new, then obviously trial and error in the laboratory first, and then to apply it to a less significant monument, and then to the king, is always based on the hierarchy.
Good evening, all. I welcome Anupatma. Okay, she is my student. I am proud to say that she is giving an informative session. And then students also very inspiring to attend this program. Thank you, Bala, and then Mamautika. Anupatma, do you
Thank
remember
you.
Me?
Yes, ma'am. Chitra ma'am in Kerala.
Yeah, Chitra?
Chitra ma'am in Kerala.
Yeah.
Awesome. Nice meeting you and talking to you again. Yes. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Another appreciation from architect Ideya.
Okay.
So, thank you, ma'am, for explaining the process through case studies, which have an idea of how it is executed. So, Ideya is a faculty now, and she must be your junior, I guess.
Okay.
Maybe 1 or 2 years after you. Wishes from her also.
So, thank you, Ideya.
Because your presentation was amazing, like we have gained more knowledge from it. Like previously we had learned it in contemporary, like this year we are learning, whereas a brief note on heritage and conservation that was given by you, it was really, really amazing. And hope once in a while these kind of eminent lectures will increase our knowledge in our field. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Question from a student from final year, Surya. She's a wonderful lecturer. And the question is, what happens if a monument is discovered while excavating Kiradi?
Okay. So they will start excavating it to the bottom level, and then they will start clearing the surface, and then they'll try to put some kind of a preservative or something like that to make it more to see. Before that, they would excavate and find the detail and document what it was, where we do have a carbon dating to find where which era it belongs to and all those things. Research work will be the initial thing, and then later they will tell us about all the findings. And then whatever they have found from the excavation, and then they will keep it for the public exhibit. So that is generally the process on a broad level.
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you. Any other questions?
The process of conservation and are the monuments, documents in BIM, if not why?
Yeah, BIM has a separate version called BIM Heritage, with which there is this digital documentation is also in progress. So they use BIM. You do have some software available in Autodesk also. I think Pixel or something. I'm not very sure about the Autodesk software, but BIM has a heritage software which can recreate a monument with the things what you can give it as a command to it. From the original monument, you can recreate that thing. Like how we were doing it, if you see Ferguson's book or Paul Pichard's book or our history books, basically, you can see a small note saying that this is being recreated, this drawing is recreated from the evidences of the old history. So those things, you can even do it, recreate it in the form of a sketch or a drawing, and then you can take it to BIM, and then you can recreate it for the virtual exhibition. That is what they are mostly doing in abroad. They are recreating Athens, Greek and French monuments, basically.
Thank you, ma'am. I think that's the end of the question and answer session. So on that note, thank you for rendering such a wonderful lecture today, ma'am. On that note, I invite Architect Balahari Krishnan to propose the word of thanks.
On behalf of the Department of Architecture, we would like to thank you, ma'am, for extending your time and sharing your wonderful presentation. Indeed, it's very simple and easy for us to understand. Also, the method what you have shown is very interesting, and it tends or moves us to be a part of this also. So thanks for your wonderful time, ma'am. On behalf of the participants also, I would like to extend my thanks to you. And our heartfelt thanks to all the participants who have been very supportive all through our lectures. We need all your support in our further lectures too. Finally, I would like to extend my thanks to our Dean and our HOD for making this possible. Thanks again, and thanks for all. Thank you.